Esteemed Rasikas, this is a momentous occasion. Indeed, we are gathered here to celebrate the musician of the 20th century, as Mr. Murali rightly described him. He should be so hailed, not only because of his monumental contribution of pioneering the music concert as we know it today, not only for fashioning and perfecting a concert format which has stood the test of time, which has been emulated by everyone, not only his disciples, and which has remained in vogue till this day, subject to minor modifications dictated by the changing lifestyles of the listeners and the consequent reduction in the concert duration from 4.5 hours to 2 hours. Not only for all these reasons should he be hailed as the musician of the 20th century, he should be so hailed because of his exceptional, unique leadership qualities, which made him an inspiring role model, Manasika Guru, and Margadarshi to other Margadarshis of the 20th century, notably Chemmangudi, GNB, and Madhuramaniyar. Such was his pervasive influence on everyone who came after him. Chemmangudi Mama, at the fag end of his life, was asked in an interview, "If you had your life to live all over again, what would be your highest ambition?" Pat came the reply, "To sing like Ariyukudi Ramanujayangar." GNB described my guru as Sangeeta Dharma Paripalaka and his music as the Gita of Sangeeta, because it typified the golden mean and ideal of the Gita. What exactly did GNB mean by the golden mean? Why is it that my guru's music should be considered the golden mean? We'll need a lot of explanation, so that may have to wait for another occasion. When my guru sang Nanupa Limpa, Madhuramaniyar, who was famously hailed as Mohanamani, came and stood in front of my guru with folded hands and tears in his eyes. Such were his admiration and reverence. My guru's musical lineage could not have been loftier. He was a fourth generation disciple of Saint Tyagaraja himself. Manambu Chavadi Venkata Subbayar was a direct disciple of Tyagabrahmam. His disciple was Patnam Subramaniyar. His disciple was Ramanathapuram Puchi Srinivasayyangar. And my guru was a disciple of Puchi Srinivasayyangar. Why is it, how is it that he reached such an exalted position, the firmament of Carnatic music, which he strode like a colossus for the greater part of the 20th century? What are the factors or the excellences in his music which took him to this exalted position where he was universally acknowledged as undisputed leader as long as he was on the scene for a full half a century? There are very solid reasons for this. There was nothing fortuitous about it. It was fully earned and richly earned. If we try to briefly look at the hallmarks of his music, we will know why he was unique. I'll just enumerate my understanding of the hallmarks of his music. I do not know if I will have time to amplify any of them on this occasion. First and foremost was his uncompromising adherence to classicism with an aristocratic disdain for artistic compromises of any kind. The edifice of Ariyakudi music, the grand edifice which we are still celebrating, 48 years after the man passed into history, that grand edifice was built upon the solid, hallowed, flawless foundation of the inspired creations of the Trinity. And that, I think, is the reason why we are still celebrating him. His allegiance to Tyaga Brahmam was such that even in the Sriraga Varnam, he would not sing Sanipa Danipama, only Sanipa Ninipama. Why? Because Devatam does not occur in Enduro and Namakusma. That was the first thing, his adherence to classicism. Second, a rich and choiceful repertoire from a wide array of composers in Sanskrit and all the South Indian languages, with a few bhajans in Hindi and Gujarati thrown in for good measure. This was one consequence of his concert format. There were two important consequences which I will briefly touch upon. The first consequence was that he banished boredom from music concerts. How did he do it? He drastically reduced the raga alapana duration. When he came on the scene, he found that a 5-hour concert consists of only 4 or 5 songs with long drawn out monotonous raga alapanas and long drawn out taniyavatanams going on for 45 minutes or 1 hour. So he started by drastically reducing the raga alapana duration. He was the very man for this mission. He is the one man who could have fashioned such a format. Why? Because he was the one musician who can give you a wholesome experience of a major raga like Todi or Sankarabharanam in 4 or 5 minutes flat. He had both the fecundity of ideas and the felicity of expression to carry off the feat gloriously. Having done that, he prevailed upon his accompanists, his violinists, not to exceed his own duration of raga alapana, even if they were senior to him. He had the leadership quality to assert himself, because time management is essentially the job of the main artist. He also prevailed upon the mridangis not to hog a disproportionate part of the concert time for taniyavatanam. All of this freed up considerable amount of time in a 4-hour, 4.5 hours concert. So what did he do? He expanded the list of songs from 4 or 5 to 14 or 15. This had two consequences. First one, he brought variety. Therefore, boredom. There was no such thing as a failed Ariyakudi concert. A failed Ariyakudi concert would be an oxymoron, like boiling ice cream. Like the great Palkiwala said, a committed judge would be an oxymoron like boiling ice cream. Failed Ariyakudi concert is also an oxymoron. And in the 1920s, in his famed Gokhale Hall concerts, which used to start at 4:15 in the evening, at 8 p.m. he would start on the miscellany and go on for an hour, sing all those patriotic songs, national songs, which were hugely popular. Droves of college students used to come and listen to this. And then they got more interested. They used to come earlier to his subsequent concerts and they learned to listen to the Todi and the Bhairavi. In this manner, he educated 2 generations of music lovers in real classicism. But that was the lesser consequence of this concert format. The more significant and profound consequence of his concert format was that but for this coming into vogue, many precious compositions of the Trinity and other great Vagyayakaras might have gone out of currency and lost to us. That is the greatest contribution that his format has achieved. So that is as far as his repertoire is concerned. And now, a sound and intelligent voice culture which kept the voice musical under all conditions. His method of voice delivery was based on full-throated ease, the relaxed use of the throat, with the result that even at age 70, he could take Music Academy or Shanmukananda by storm by hitting the Tarasthai Panchama effortlessly in Nidhichala Sukuma and Subramanya Namaste and Ambananda Prabhuve. After one of his Bombay concerts, he came to Alleppey for a concert and he told us, Bombay-la Raj Kapoor-nu oru pramukhar irukkarame cinema-la avar enna ketar inge eppadi 70 vayasula voice eppadi vechindirukke idukkaga neenga enna pandreel unga voice eppadi kaapathrathukku enna pandreel nu ketar naan voice-ukkaga naan pandrathu sangeetham dhaan appdi solliten avarte appdi sonnar. So his technique was so sound that even at age 70 he could achieve this kind of unimaginable perfection even in the higher reaches which younger musicians cannot dream of. So sound was his voice technique. Then the primacy of Madhyama Kala. He gave central importance to Madhyama Kala in his concerts, again because the major part of the compositions of Tyagaraja are in the Madhyama Kala. He found that he had the ability to do justice to gamakas in any speed. He was the one musician who had the felicity in the widest range of kala pramanas from very slow to very fast. He was the only musician of all the great musicians we have heard who had the felicity in the widest range of kala pramanas. At one end of this spectrum, slow end of the spectrum, he could do justice to the gamakas in Achalingi Vibho and Ambarandu Brahuve and Subramanya Namaste. At the other end of the spectrum, he could do justice to Nipadame, Ninujuchi, Nikelana, which is at Varanarada, all at scorching speeds. And then he did some interesting experiments because his laya mastery was such. He did some interesting experiments. His laya mastery was not limited to arithmetic, clever arithmetic. It went much deeper than that. He treated laya as the sheet anchor upon which to lift the majesty and lift the melodies. So he experimented with many kala pramanas, especially in the segment between Madhyama Kala and Chauka Kala. He came up with many tricky kala pramanas, which were a challenge to execute, which were a challenge to accompany, but he was able to bring out beauteous graces of the raga in the process. Examples are Ninuvina Sukumagana, Hecharike Gara, Ongi Ulakalanda, Nadamadi Thirinda. There are many other examples. In that tantalizing gait, he was able to do justice. So, then we have to mention his gamakas. He was the treasurer of gamakas, the lifeblood of Carnatic music. But he never indulged them to excess. He recognized that certain ragas need the plain note or two to retain their swarupa and not sound wilted and withered. Like for example, in Puri Kalyani, he always used to strike the Antara Gantara in a robust and plain manner. If you overdo the gamaka of, if you apply gamaka to the Gantara of Puri Kalyani, you will end up in Saveri. He never made that mistake. Aesthetic discrimination was the keynote of his artistry. He never indulged anything to excess. He had a fine sense of proportion. And then, one very important excellence of his music was his enunciation. Just as the bowing technique or the fingering technique determines the character of instrumental music, it is the pronunciation, the uchcharanam, which determines the character of vocal music. If in the name of bhava, if you mumble, chew and mangle the sahitya, that kind of pronunciation is tamasic. If in the name of spashtam, you pronounce the sahitya so harshly as to reduce music to speech, and every syllable sticks out like a sore thumb from the swarasthana, that kind of pronunciation is rajasic. Whereas, if you pronounce it, if your pronunciation is distinct enough to be intelligible but soft enough to be musical, that pronunciation is sattvic pronunciation. My guru was an exemplar of sattvic pronunciation. It's an extremely important virtue of his music, which has been extolled by the likes of Mushri, Palghat Manir and GNB in what they have written about his music. He had the ability to gauge the expectations of the audience like a mind reader. He could draw the best out of any accompanist, whether he was a stalwart or a beginner. There are many other excellences of his music which I could talk about at length, but time does not permit me to go into greater detail. Suffice it to say that his music came to be seen as the yardstick by which the classicism of others could be measured, because it was a compendium of so many excellences. And before I conclude this lecture about him, I cannot do so without talking about Todi. You cannot talk about Ariyakudi without talking about Todi. You cannot talk about Todi without talking about Ariyakudi. He had an incredible repertoire in Todi alone. Legend has it that it was 70, 80, 90, nobody knows for sure. But what we do know for sure is that while you can extol his Todi as incomparable, peerless, the ultimate Todi and so on, and you would be absolutely right doing that, a better way to understand his Todi is to recognize, to realize that his Todi was simply beyond adjectives. It was the Todi. And what was so special about it? What was special about it was his Todi Raga Alapana was the distilled essence of the Todi found in the compositions of the Trinity. There would not be a single extraneous phrase. It is not right to call his Todi Gayakabani Todi except to distinguish it from Nayanabani Todi. We should actually call it Ariyakudi Todi, because some great singers have also sung Nayanabani Todi in a big way, especially Shamangudi Mama in the earlier part of his career, and GNB for most of his career resorted to Nayanabani Todi. I have practiced both versions of the Todi, though as a policy I will never sing Nayanabani Todi in my concerts, being a disciple of Ariyakudi. And I found that Ariyakudi Todi is far more rigorous and demanding. Whereas in the Nayanabani Todi, you have a lot of leeway. It permits you freely to invite guest appearances from Ahiri, Dhanyasi, Natabhairavi, Dhenuka, Hindolam, Sindhubhairavi, and so on. Whereas in the Ariyakudi Todi, you are not allowed to hit a Karvai on Rishabham, Gandharam, Daivatam, Vishadam. It's a complete no-no. These notes can be given only with Gamakas 99.99% of the time. And it is because his Todi was Todi all the way, without a single phrase suggesting any other raga, and richly suggesting the great compositions of the Trinity, that is what makes his Todi unique. On this occasion, if we can make a choice to keep Nayanabani Todi for Ragam Thanam Pallavi if you are enamored of it. But if you want to sing Ninne Namminanu, if you want to sing Dasarathi, Raju Vedalu, Ninnuvina Sugamugana, if you sing Ariyakudi Todi, there will be no mismatch. There will be no incompatibility, like they say in software terms these days all the time. There will be no incompatibility between the Raga Alapana and the Kriti rendering. But if you sing Nayanabani Todi and sing Ninne Namminanu or Ninnuvina Sugamugana, you suddenly get a feeling that you sang one raga and you are rendering a kriti in a different raga. Anyway, that is a thought that I wanted to share. There is much more to say about the excellences of his music, but I'm sure you would also like me to share some music, some of his great music with you. So I look forward to doing that. Thank you very much.